Hey, we're live.
Good afternoon, everybody. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Jeff Thomason. I'm the Deputy Librarian at the RNCM, and I am delighted this afternoon to introduce Dr. Rachel Johnson. Rachel and I did our PhDs together at the college almost at the same time, and our areas overlap to a certain extent. And so I always associate Rachel with the long 19th century. And she achieved her PhD. Was it earlier this year, Rachel, or last year? It was earlier this year. And she achieved the rare distinction of passing without corrections. And she's now working with us at the college, and she's engaged on a research project, which is tangential, I think, to what she was doing before. I mean, she did a lot of work, I know, on military bands, brass bands, army bands around the time of the First World War. But now she's moved a bit further forward on that. She's still going to talk about the theme of army bands, but at a later date, and how the discourse of military music impacts on bands today. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Rachel. Welcome, Rachel.
Thank you very much for that lovely introduction, Jeff. I just need to very quickly try and get the PowerPoint working. And we want sound. Hopefully this will work. It does have some video at some point, which hopefully won't be too clunky, but we'll find out. There we go. Right. So it seems appropriate that this talk falls completely by accident so soon after Remembrance Sunday. I began my abstract for this talk with the statement, military bands are firmly embedded in the cultural life of Britain. And when is this better illustrated than each November, when it is almost impossible to avoid seeing and hearing military bands and buglers, whether in person or at a regional event or via live coverage and press reportage of the ceremony in London. I have a little video. How many of us have heard this many times over the last week? So that was London on Sunday. Think back over the past few months to other recent state and ceremonial occasions, and even in this continuing pandemic year, the public utility of bands is quickly evident. Yet apart from the immediate spectacle of a band during a grand event, there seems to be little public awareness of what army bands and musicians actually do. Within academic circles, military music has long been overlooked as a field of inquiry, perhaps dismissed previously by musicologists as inferior to the established canon of Western art music, and neglected by historians wary of engaging with music at all. The expansion of cultural historical approaches to music in recent decades has begun to change this situation, and there has been some excellent recent work on bands in the 19th and early 20th centuries, but the current work and recent history of British Army music remains largely undocumented. In today's talk, I hope to explore some of the breadth of work present-day British Army bands and musicians engage in particularly in relation to recent conflicts. I will consider this work through the lens of published doctrine and guidance, bearing these questions in mind. What intentions and assumptions underpin the deployment of music and musicians in situations of conflict? How is such music used and received in practice? What impact do British Army bands have in the context of modern warfare? And what might their future look like? Before I go any further, I really do need to address my position. Our RNCM colleagues will know me primarily as a researcher into the musical life of Victorian Manchester, and may be aware that I'm also a flautist. Not all of you will know that I'm also a serving soldier in the Army Reserve. And here is me on Sunday, out for Remembrance in Manchester. I have been principal flute of an Army Reserve band, the Lancashire Artillery Band, since 2010, and have gradually picked up additional duties and rank to the point that I'm now Bombardier Johnson. I love the fact I'm a bombardier, this is a fairly new thing, and spend about half of my working week doing a mixture of musical and media duties for the band, the Lancashire Artillery Pipes and Drums, and 216 Battery Royal Artillery, all of which fall under the command of 103 Regiment Royal Artillery. It is the dual position I have in both academic and military worlds which has inspired this research. There are regular moments in my military life and when listening to papers at conferences where I have been left thinking, this particular facet of army music is really interesting in relation to this particular academic line of inquiry. I have also had many conversations with military colleagues, and this is my band in this picture here, some of my band, where I have been left thinking, this is really important and needs to be documented. To give a few examples, we have an outstanding library. This is part of it. I was trying to take photos of it last week. It's very difficult to take photos of the whole thing. It's quite small. There's a bit more. We've got more than 2,000 boxes of music. Each box has 2 to 4 pieces in it. We've also got 660 named boxes of marches, each of which has 5 to 6 sets of marches in. And there's also quite a large amount of uncatalogued music. This has come about as a result of, we had the original Lancashire Artillery Band library was supplemented a few years ago by the band of the King's Division Library when they were turned into a brass band. We got all of their music. And most recently, we've acquired all of the library of the Royal Artillery Band when that was disbanded. This is all in a Army Reserve Centre in Bolton. And if anyone would ever like to borrow anything from it or come and look at it, please get in touch, because we really do want to make this more available to people to come to access. I have a real fondness for the old brown music held together by lots of tape, overtures to forgotten light operas, fantasias and suites based on obscure melodies from long forgotten times. There are overtures which are generally forgotten in other quarters, which remain canonic within military mess band repertoire, for which programming generally still follows an 1840s miscellaneous program structure. I've sat next to my bandmaster as he's planned that we need a march, then we need an overture, then we need a suite. And the structure is the same as programmes I was looking at for Manchester in 1840. But the precise music slotted into those categories might change. So whereas previously you might have had a suite from a light opera, now you have a suite from Les Mis or other classic wind band pieces that I'm sure many of us have played. And these continuing living musical connections with a neglected past I find really intriguing. The history of the band of the Women's Royal Army Corps is also fascinating, specifically the point at which it was disbanded in 1992, and the women were scattered into bands across the country, generally against strong opposition from some of their male colleagues. As recently as 2015, one of my colleagues, a former regular soldier approaching retirement age, was telling me that women shouldn't be in the bands, they only cause trouble. I think he forgot I was a woman, and it wasn't intended with any malice, it wasn't aimed at me, but these attitudes are very much still there. I'm not planning on talking about these elements today. They're surviving archival traces, and they can wait for another day. What I would like to begin to explore today are the lived experiences of musicians in recent conflicts, which are not really documented or recorded or known about, even within the military. While my position gives me privileged access, it does also bring some potentially challenging constraints. The stories I include in my talk today can be classed as personal communications. I've already double-checked that with Michelle and with regard to ethics. But if I'm to take this research where I want to, I will need to go through ethical clearance. That's fine, that's expected. But as a serving soldier, I'm also bound by the Army Defence Information Notice, contact with the media and communicating in public. This obligates me to seek approval to speak and approval of my content from my chain of command. If my content avoids controversial matters, then approval from my immediate bosses, who trust me and are very supportive of this work. And if they happen to be watching on YouTube at the moment, hello, sir, hello, ma'am, that's fine. They're very happy to approve this. If I wish to be more critical, then I need to take my work to a quite Orwellian sounding Directorate of Defence Communications Secretariat. And they have the power of veto over this work. As this project develops, it may require plenty of diplomacy on my part to retain academic freedom while also retaining the support of the Army for this research. Support and trust are key to this research on a personal level as well as an institutional level. So while the rules could be perceived as limits, I think I need to frame it as an additional interesting aspect of doing academic work with the military. The primary inspiration for this research is conversations I have had with colleagues since I joined my band. I feel extremely fortunate that colleagues trust me with their stories, but the nature of their work means it is simply a fact that some of the material is appropriate for the public domain, while other elements have been shared in confidence. I have to be sensitive to those boundaries and to handle my colleagues' stories with care, partly because I don't want them to stop talking to me, partly because they're not my stories, and partly because, for multiple non-sinister reasons, I should say, aspects of some of the stories I have been entrusted with have the potential to do real harm, which as an academic musicologist is not a space I've really found myself in before. Hopefully this all gives you a bit of a steer towards what this talk is and what it isn't. It's an early foray into a new area, and it's quite often anecdotal, but my research in this area to date points towards a number of areas of future research interest. It is inevitably diplomatically framed, but still raises some important and challenging questions. I'm also really hoping it will prompt discussion and conversation, either later today or over a glass of wine on a future occasion. I'm really happy to see colleagues from so many different areas of the college and elsewhere here, because while I have spotted areas which are relevant, I think, to historical musicology, to music psychology, to music therapy, to music education, to performance studies, I'm really curious to see what aspects of this talk spark your interest. Where do you see the potential intersections with your disciplinary interests? What collaborative directions might I take this work? And what methodological and theoretical approaches might I try? To give a very brief history of army music, British army bands may be traced back several hundred years. The Royal Artillery Band, pictured here, as it combined my reserve band and the Royal Artillery Band, was originated in 1557 and granted official status in 1762. This photo was taken at the 300th anniversary of the band at the UBK 300 parade. Bands proliferated during the late 18th and early 19th centuries, but were generally pet projects of individual officers, intended as much, perhaps more, for private entertainment in the mess as for any specifically military role. A major step towards organisation and oversight came after a parade at Scutari in 1854 during the Crimean War. So the story goes, at a grand parade to celebrate the birthday of Queen Victoria, the attending massed bands all struck up the national anthem, but in multiple different keys. The Duke of Cambridge established Kneller Hall, the School of Army Music, as a direct consequence. And I should say, we very nearly had a similar thing happen in Manchester on Sunday. My band and the police band had the hymns in different keys, and it was only a last minute, let's just start the hymns from the boss, just before we formed up to start the parade that averted a bit of a disaster. By the time of the First World War, it's hard to get a handle on exactly how many bands existed. But as each new battalion aimed to raise its own band, I can reasonably confidently say that the bands numbered in their hundreds. From the Second World War onwards, the picture is one of cuts rather than growth, at least in terms of pure numbers, reflective of cuts across the army. In 1956, the British Army numbered more than 3 million soldiers. Options for change, the restructuring which followed the end of the Cold War, reduced the size of the regular army to around 120,000 people. Army 2020 reduced the size of the regular army to 82,000 soldiers, and a further reduction to 72,500 regular soldiers by 2025 was announced this year. Mapping these reductions onto the bands, just to give a few key points. In 1993, the Chief of the General Staff announced a reduction from 69 regular army bands to 29. Implementing this reduction fundamentally changed how these bands were organised through the establishment of the Corps of Army Music in 1994. Previously, each band belonged to its regiment, but after the restructure, while the bands kept the names and uniforms of the regiments to which they were attached, and many regiments lost their bands, which led to some very heated debates in the House of Lords, which you can track in Hansard if you're interested, the bands officially fell under the new corps. From colleagues who were in at this point, from speaking to them about it, it was the regiments took it really personally, even people at quite low rank, that their band was suddenly no longer their band. And overnight, musicians walking around the camp were being shunned by people who previously had been their friends, their fellow soldiers, because they weren't their band anymore and they didn't want to talk to them. The next major structural change followed Future Army Music 2020, which was published in 2013 and was linked to the Army 2020 review. As well as further reducing personnel numbers, this was a point at which the army re-rolled some of the existing bands into three brass bands, three specialist rock and pop capability bands, and one string orchestra. It felt like no sooner had these changes settled than the next round of cuts arrived, announced in 2019 and taking effect last year. There are now just 14 regular army bands, and those lost include the Royal Artillery Band. The oldest band in the British Army is officially no more. Nella Hall has been sold too. The final farewell concert took place this summer. The training of junior musicians is now co-located with the Royal Marines School of Music. The new Corps headquarters and higher training wing, where training in musical direction will take place, are located at Minley, where there is no band. I won't comment any further on that fact. The Corps has acquired royal status this year and is now the Royal Corps of Army Music, RCAM. And again, I will highlight without further comment the irony of being awarded royal status in a year of such drastic cuts. There are also 20 Army Reserve bands. Just to confuse you all further, the Army Reserve bands still belong to their regiments, not to RCAM, although RCAM has some oversight of standards. A reserve-focused defence review, following on from the Reserve Forces Defence Review 2030, published in May this year, is due out next week, and reserve bands are unlikely to escape unscathed this time. Taking a dispassionate view, the cuts are understandable. Within the past 20 years alone, there have, of course, been two extended counterinsurgency operations, a financial crisis and a pandemic, all of which are rather expensive. But it is still hard not to feel nostalgic for all that has been lost. I don't just want to document a vanishing culture, however, though I think it is important. I want to ask deeper questions about what military bands are intended to achieve, who determines how and why musicians are deployed, and what happens in practice. To explore this, I've been delving into defence doctrine. JSP 813, Instructions for Service Bands and Military Musicians. The mission statement of bands is, through music, sorry, it's come up with a, hopefully, if you start seeing funny things on my screen, let me know. I got a strange notification pop up just then. Through music, service bands are to sustain and develop the moral component of fighting power, support state ceremonial, and achieve influence in order to further defence and national interests. UK Defence Doctrine, which is publicly available on government web pages, defines the moral component of fighting power as being about getting people to fight. It splits it into three interrelated functions, which you'll see bottom right on this image: moral cohesion, motivation, and leadership. The section on moral cohesion is the section with which army music has tended to most closely align itself. Here we find detailed in the doctrine. Moral cohesion is built on shared experiences, a common sense of worth, appropriate discipline, and collective identity. It is sustained by shared common values and standards, and it embodies genuine and deep comradeship that endures even as the experience of violence and fear of death and injury begin to pervade an individual's conscious and subconscious. The definition continues, a feeling of pride and mutual loyalty uniting the members of a group, an esprit de corps, reinforces unit identity and cements moral cohesion. Three key aspects of moral cohesion are then covered in more detail. A professional ethos, quote, an exemplary professional ethos combined with an appealing cultural identity and strong military reputation is a powerful moral force in its own right. This passage is then linked to the values and standards of the British Army, which every soldier covers in training every single year. Self-esteem, which it links to a sense of belonging. And tradition, team cohesion is strengthened by a sense of heritage, infused by professional reputation and fostered through shared identity. Tradition and custom, manifested in ceremonies, uniforms, museums, and service distinctions, are critical ingredients in promoting and sustaining an esprit de corps. The commitment to prevail on operations, whatever the personal cost, is reinforced by an established and proven national and service reputation for excellence and a consciousness of being part of that tradition. Let us link this document directly to JSP 813. I've not managed to find out who wrote this, but it looks as though it has been carefully and deliberately mapped against the defence doctrine to demonstrate as clearly as possible the utility of bands within defence policy. It begins, point 0101, music is utilised in the British Armed Forces as a source of influence. It contributes to the moral component of fighting power by supporting the ethos, tradition, and identity of our personnel. The universality of music is a powerful tool available to commanders as a source of communication and positive influence. Military music sustains support for formations at home, on operations, and as a means of UK defence influence around the globe. It then itemises different tasks. The defence contribution to UK influence, state ceremonial, which in the text it goes on to say it's regarded as an essential part of the fabric of the nation. They are charged with tasks that are symbolic and represent centuries of British tradition. Emblems of patriotism, their sound stirs the soul. Unit support. So service bands are tasked to support the ethos of the armed forces by reinforcing through music the pride, comradeship and traditions that service personnel share. Community engagement and recruiting. Troop morale support, so contributing to the moral component of fighting power by entertaining service personnel and providing respite during ongoing operations. Peace support operations, service bands are tasked to engage with the local population in operational theatres, paving the way for cooperation and communication. Many of these, you may say, are linked to soft power, and UK Defence Doctrine explicitly defines soft power. Soft power may influence others to adopt a preferred course of action through cultural and ideological means or by encouraging emulation. The instruments of power, including defence engagement activities, can make a significant contribution and can be used to support soft power being generated. This, in summary, is the framework within which British Army bands work. They are one of many instruments of power. Instruments as instruments of power is a nice sideline there, frequently deployed as an instrument of defence diplomacy. I find my own response to the use of language in these documents fascinating, and I don't know if any of you are finding the same from the excerpts here. I know rationally that music can be used to influence, to exclude, to maintain boundaries, to potentially be used for harm, and I found this intellectually intriguing for some time. But at the same time, my own experience of music and the way it is more commonly framed and described is largely positive. The ways in which music builds community, brings people together, is regarded as universal and a common language, which are presented in these documents as fact incidentally. Music is universal, which is interesting in itself. There is a gulf between my physical and emotional experience of what music is to me and my understanding of what music has the potential to do. How this framework manifests at home is a relatively familiar story to anyone with a passing awareness of the existence of military bands. In addition to concert and marching formations, most bands can also put out a variety of small ensembles, brass and wind quintets, Dixie bands, singers, solo pianists, and so on. The sorts of engagements bands play at beyond the big events are not likely to be particularly surprising to you either. They can loosely be categorised into parades, beating retreat and sunset ceremonies, concerts, often in association with connected charities such as the Royal British Legion or Army Benevolent Fund, church services, and community engagement events, for example, working with schools. What might surprise you is the sheer number of events military bands attend. Since November the 6th, my band alone has supported 12 distinct events, 2 football matches, 2 full concerts, buglers at 4 separate locations on the 11th of November, 1 church service, and the band, the pipes and the buglers at 4 separate locations on Remembrance Sunday. This is just one reserve band. Scale this up across all of the regular and reserve bands and you get a pretty phenomenal amount of music making. Deployment of bands is often functional. They are generally present to fulfil a specific musical need at a primarily non-musical event. And depending on the circumstances, the music they play may be required to fit a rigid structure. But within that structure, there is plenty of space for creativity and playfulness. If you have ever seen any of the video of the changing of the guard, you may have noticed that the static pieces, in particular, vary to suit specific events. For example, the band playing the Three Lions during this year's football European Cup, wasn't it? And the James Bond theme around the time of the premiere of the most recent film. I'd like to illustrate this brief summary of the musical work bands are currently doing with a recording my band put out last year. I'm in charge of media for my band, and I had a very steep learning curve in producing digital outputs, particularly because my director of music and permanent staff instructor both kept on having brilliant ideas, which I was then required to execute. We put out 54 distinct videos between March 2020 and the new year, but our most substantial production was a full beating retreat for VJ Day 75. I'll play you the element which formed the heart of this video. This came after the march on and before the sunset elements. I think it's a useful example of the core work British Army bands still do. It was devised for a national commemorative occasion, but adapted practically and musically to fit the circumstances of the pandemic. It engaged with veterans of the conflict. I had the lovely experience of interviewing one of the Burn veterans down the phone and recording them reading a poem for this. And it drew on connections members of the band had with Burn veterans through family and through charitable work. The arrangement of this was made by WO2 Spate, our permanent staff instructor. And he creates moments within this music for it to speak to the present as much as to the past. If you listen out for the piccolo entry about halfway through, bearing in mind that this was recorded just as the first lockdown was beginning to ease, you will hopefully see what I'm getting at.
By the old Norwegian pagoda, looking lazy at the sea, there's a Burma girl a-sitting, and I know she thinks of me. The wind is in the palm trees, and the temple bells, they say, come you back, you British soldier, come you back to Mandalay. Can't you hear their paddles clunking from Rangoon to Mandalay? On the road to Mandalay, where the flying fishes play, and the dawn comes up like thunder out of China crossed the bay. Come you back, you busy soldier, come you back to Mandalay. Come you back. Thank you.
The gentleman in short shorts towards the end of that video, a young man in uniform, was actually my great-grandfather. So it was quite nice from a personal perspective to be able to. He never spoke about his time in time in Burma at all, right up until the point at which he died. So it's quite easy to equate the peacetime work of bands with defence doctrine. Tradition, identity, belonging, unit cohesion, shared values and standards, pride and loyalty, building the esprit de corps, which is so vital in times of conflict. But what roles do army musicians have in that conflict when it arises? There's still a tendency in popular understanding to equate military musicians with stretcher bearers, which is the role most people believe military musicians took on during World War I. Even during World War I, the picture was more nuanced than that, with musicians deployed to other roles too, and sometimes deployed as musicians. That said, an association did persist for much of the 20th century between military bands and medics. This association never appears to have been a straightforward, easy to define one though, and has become ever more complicated in recent conflicts. Until the beginning of the Iraq War, it remained the norm for bands to deploy as a band in a defined operational role. The military hierarchy realised a while ago, however, that it was not very cost-effective to spend time and money fully training musicians to be medics when they could just as usefully deploy as medical assistants or to complete general duties of some sort or another. Terry, a saxophone player in my band when I first joined, described his deployment to the First Gulf War, picture there, as doing all the jobs no one else wanted to do, which, if I recall correctly, amounted to lots of cleaning and scrubbing and emptying of bins. But he was quite happy with this situation, as it was work which needed to be done, and as he put it, the proper medics appreciated them doing it. Terry also told me tales of taking shelter in a ditch, watching cruise missiles passing overhead and hoping they were going somewhere other than the oil refinery his band were sheltering next to. There is something of a jolt which comes with recognising these are proper wars with a genuine risk to life. Members of the Signals band told me about their deployment to Kosovo, a tour they were enjoying as they played football with children in the fields near their village, until they were told afterwards that that field was a minefield. As the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan progressed, bands ceased to be deployed as a whole unit in a non-musical role. Instead, musicians deployed as individual augmentees. What this means is that individual musicians volunteered to deploy and received focused training for a specific non-musical role with a different unit, for example, as a driver. As well as individual augmentees, bands were deployed as whole units, but in their primary role to serve operationally as musicians. Here are some examples which illustrate this broad sweep. Lieutenant Colonel Bob Meldrum, the previous picture was his as well, former Principal Director of Music, CAMIS, joined the army in 1975 as an oboist. He became a bandmaster and deployed to the First Gulf War in 1990-91, Kosovo for the millennium, and Iraq in 2006. In the First Gulf War, they deployed as a band and took and used their instruments, but they were also used in their combat role, which was medical linked. Bob Meldrum commanded a field ambulance, transporting casualties and fatalities. He has spoken publicly, and the video is available online if you're interested. It's the Musical Brain Conference about music and the trauma of war. He's spoken publicly about the in-theatre post-conflict period, where the band were expected to switch instantly back to a musical role, playing solemn music as repatriation flights were loaded. As he puts it, his musicians had gone from recovering bodies and dealing with traumatic injuries to playing their instruments for those who did not make it. By the time of his Kosovo deployment, they were primarily deployed on musical duties, but also assisted in entirely non-technical ways in the hospital. By 2006, it was a musical deployment as a pop band. Sergeant Liam Compson. I saved this the other week. It popped up on my Facebook timeline. I thought this will be a brilliant example. And then I remembered today that actually I met Sergeant Compson. I had a command leadership and management course I attended 2 years ago, and he was one of the instructors. And I had a bit of a chat with him then about his deployments. He was so enthusiastic about this is an even more fledgling project at that point then, but he wanted it to happen. He wanted to talk to me. He wanted this to be shared because he deployed as well as two musical deployments. He also deployed as a top cover gunner in Afghanistan. And for a musician to deploy in such a direct combat role, that is still quite unusual. Matt Spate, who I will call Matt because he is my immediate boss. He is bottom right in this picture. And yes, he is that huge. Hello, Matt, if you are watching this. He deployed in October 2010 on Op Herrick 13. He was at that point a bandmaster and WO1. and he deployed as the Theatre Inventory and General Equipment Register Team Warrant Officer. So to explain that, his duties were to account for and report to land forces on the location and ownership of all of the vehicle platforms, over 3,000 vehicle platforms in Afghanistan. 6 weeks into the deployment, his team was cut as a cost-saving measure after the strategic defence review, and Matt acquired a new role as Capability Integration Warrant Officer. Matt explains his role was to coordinate the issue and withdrawal of vehicle platforms across Afghanistan and to ensure every vehicle was at theatre entry standard. So this translates to making sure all the equipment schedules for the vehicles, the radio systems, the weapon system, and the electronic countermeasures were all in good order and that the vehicles themselves worked properly. Matt tells me that although his training and work as a bandmaster had, quoting directly here, prepared him for assimilating information quickly, this was a vertical learning curve. The role also brought some very challenging moments, and he's talked very candidly to me about these. Issuing vehicles to enthusiastic crews, which within days were hit by IEDs. Receiving and sanitising battle-damaged platforms. I'm sure you can imagine what that must mean. The Paraband and the Army Air Corps Band both visited while Matt was deployed. He clearly recalls the pride he felt when the AAC Band played for the Bastion Remembrance Day Parade. To quote Matt, over my time in Afghanistan, I had a very tangible feeling that my work was of value and in direct support to operations. I had exactly the same feeling as I watched the professionalism of the para and AAC bands who were in theatre performing musically. I've actually found a bit of a recording on YouTube of that Remembrance Day service in Afghanistan in 2010. Even musical deployments brought sometimes unexpected risks. A colleague has described to me his deployment to Afghanistan on a short musical tour, where they unexpectedly found themselves in dangerous territory while transiting between engagements, and he was ordered to give top cover, i.e. stick his head out the top of a vehicle and wield his rifle. The changing nature of contemporary warfare prompted some serious thought about what musical capabilities deployed bands needed. Providing the traditional contributions for a remembrance service is one thing, but what about when travelling between forward operating bases playing for the troops? Major Guy Booth, my current director of music, who I did invite along to see if he wanted to talk today, and he's otherwise engaged, but says hello, and he may be watching on YouTube, in which case, hello, sir. I've managed to borrow some of his talk from the Musical Brain conference as well, so you will get some of his own words shortly. He pioneered the development of the Army's first specialist rock and pop capability band, the AGC band, so Adjutant General's Corps band, in direct response to what he saw as the musical needs of this conflict. It was modelled in part on what Glenn Miller did during World War II. I assumed this was part of some overarching strategy when I first heard about this reorganisation, but having spoken to Guy about this again recently, he saw the need and he pushed it forwards. Military bands in Afghanistan could go where other musicians could not, and Guy's mantra became, whatever they've got on their iPods, we've got to play. He deployed with his band for an 8-week tour over a Christmas New Year period to carry out welfare and troop morale support on operations through the provision of music. They did more than 100 gigs in 60 days across all of the areas of Afghanistan where British troops were deployed, so they were able to access the forward operating bases where non-military units simply could not go. Some of this was quite straightforward music as entertainment. He's got a great anecdote of the new James Bond film, which at that point was Skyfall, had just been released. And unknown to the troops, Daniel Craig wanted to bring it to show the film to the troops in Bastion. And so they set up a showing, and a top secret was that Daniel Craig was there too. So at the point that the band struck up the Bond theme, got to do-da-da-da, in came Daniel Craig, which went down brilliantly with everyone who was there. Conversely, and I will leave this bit to Major Booth.
We needed to know our audience. So we needed to know the locations. What could we take to the locations? We needed to know things like the kinetic influence, i.e. how serious was the fighting? Because believe you me, it was serious, and it is still serious. We also needed to know the overall dynamic within the unit. What I mean by that is sort of local issues. So have there been any recent deaths? Serious injuries, because we're not going to go piling in and go, hey, come on, this is us, when 2 days ago somebody was shot in the back playing football, which is exactly what happened. We needed to know that music, and we needed to believe, which we wholeheartedly did, that music in its varying forms affects people. And we had to make sure that we could go in and affect these people in the right way. Choose the charts, this is key. My mantra always from day one was, whatever they listen to on their iPods is what we have to be playing. There is no point in taking a brass quintet and playing Gilbert and Sullivan, as much as I like it, to a bunch of soldiers who've had no support or no entertainment, and it's Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. Just doesn't work. It's been tried, proven, doesn't work. So we went over there playing Bruno Mars, J-Lo, Daft Punk, Jessie J, and then we went a little bit older because we've got a whole mixture, so Bryan Adams, my time, Tracy Chapman, but also Ollie Murs, Maroon 5, Evanescence, a complete mixture of music that the guys and girls were listening to, because why else will they get out of their warm sleeping bags to come and listen to us if it's not going to be good music? And then you've got a plan for the unexpected. It's a war zone. The unexpected happens. For example, electrical failure. We started on Christmas Eve in one patrol base, 150 Estonians there and about 40 Brits. And we did our first number and they all went, right, brilliant. Then the power went. Right, keyboard player, you can go and get a non-alcoholic beer because the Estonians had it. You know, non-alcoholic, it's very tasty. But he went and got a non-alcoholic beer. And the rest of us did an hour and a half, completely unplugged. Two of us doing vocals, one guitar and one cajon player. Boy, it was hard. Planned for the unexpected. We did, we knew we could do it. And going back to the whole piece about what is the state in that unit. We had, as I mentioned earlier, a chap who in November was shot in the back playing football and killed. We went 2 days later to visit that location, and I had a cajon, guitar and a vocalist. And the chap that met us off the helicopter had carried his best friend in a body bag onto the helicopter and carried after that the chap that had shot him, still alive at the time, onto the helicopter. And he was greeting me and I was thinking, this is just, you know, unbelievable. We shouldn't be doing, you know, what should we do? And he said, no, we need you. So we set up in the cafe, three of us, just started jamming quietly. Folks started coming along. We did about an hour and a half, and I think 30 plus people came in, had a brew, read the paper, whatever they were doing. And as they were leaving, every one of them said, thank you. You have made a difference. You have taken me out of my reality. And that's the power of music, without a doubt.
So you might find it interesting to know that Guy trained with Nordoff Robbins after leaving the regular army, and he works as a music therapist now. As the events in Iraq and Afghanistan have reached their conclusions, British Army bands have had to reframe their ongoing and future relevance yet again. One avenue which has been interesting and fruitful is that of musical diplomacy through deployment as short-term training teams. On the one hand, this fits more comfortably with how we like to think of music. Music building bridges, music as a common language, music bringing people together. Look a bit deeper, however, and here we see another situation in which music is being used as a soft power. It fits neatly into military doctrine about instruments of national power, the diplomatic instrument, the economic instrument, the military instrument, in relation to ideas around the utility of defence. Military bands often occupy the space of a military instrument deployed diplomatically to further defence interests and achieve influence. A quick search brings up recent CAMUS, ARCAM, short-term training teams in countries including Ethiopia, Jordan, Kenya, Kosovo, Zimbabwe, Albania, Montenegro, Uganda, Estonia, and Malawi. So there's definitely an Eastern European focus and an African focus in recent years. The Integrated Review, published in March 2021, Defence in a Competitive Age. I found this quite an alarming document for many reasons. This passage from the foreword communicates the gist of it quite well. So the foreword from the Secretary of State for Defence, the integrated operating concept published last year recognises that changes in the information and political environments now impact not just the context, but conduct of military operations. The notion of war and peace as binary states has given way to a continuum of conflict, requiring us to prepare our forces for more persistent global engagement and constant campaigning, moving seamlessly from operating to warfighting. The armed forces working with the rest of government must think and act differently. They will no longer be held as a force of last resort, but become more present and active around the world, operating below the threshold of open conflict to uphold our values and secure our interests, partner our friends, and enable our allies. It promises a more streamlined, integrated force, deployed more frequently around the world, but often operating below the level of open conflict. The opening foreword includes all of the government buzz of global Britain, but the bulk of the text is a far more sober document. A more assertive defence capability is promised, more persistently and proactively engaged overseas. The wording is very strong. The UK defence doctrine had a prominent place for soft power in defence engagement. This review reads as a statement of intent refocused on hard power, with a particular emphasis on science and technology. This is the background against which the latest structuring of army music is trying to find its niche and is working to champion and communicate its continued utility. This adds extra edge to its assertions about what music does, and is also the point at which I have to be quite careful what I say. The therapeutic use of music by army bands was briefly explored around the time of the conference Major Booth attended, then seems to have gone very quiet. The utility of contemporary bands was clear during the Iraq and Afghan campaigns. It has been less so subsequently. Short-term training teams are very media-friendly and have been really pushed quite recently by ARCAM, CAMUS as a way forwards, but they're perhaps not quite having the impact on policy yet that was hoped for, particularly as policy shifts back towards hard power. Bands currently have an operational role as medical decontamination teams with a CBRN, so chemical, biological, radiological and nuclear decontamination. And the paraband have fairly recently done a big period of training in that role. But where this has been pushed in the media is, look at what the paraband are doing, and has picked up some media coverage. By emphasising the non-musical utility of musicians as a way of justifying their existence takes things down a different route again. For me, all these debates and discussions prompt some interesting questions. To what extent are claims about the potential power of music in the military evidence-based? And to what extent are they rhetoric aimed up the chain? What might the stories of musicians who have deployed tell us about power and influence through music? What about the stories of those they played to? What might all this mean for defence doctrine? What might it mean in the context of broader debates about the place of music in our present society, our schools, our universities? The army may be unusual in how explicitly it positions music as a tool, but musicians and musical institutions are all on the defensive at the moment, and there are areas where army music seems to act as an interesting microcosm of a much bigger debate. We end up with the big perennial questions. What does music mean? How does music mean? I feel like I ought to end with some satisfying conclusions, but as I said at the start, this is a preliminary step in a project I really want to take further, and I would love your thoughts on where I might go next. I'd love to hand over to you all for questions now, and I really would welcome any thoughts and ideas this may have prompted about music and conflict in relation to your own work too. Thank you very much for listening. It's been lovely to have a chance to talk about this, and I look forward to questions.
Thank you very much, Rachel, for what I think is a very, very thought-provoking presentation. And I know this is probably nothing more than coincidence, but I am very much aware of the irony of asking a Quaker pacifist to introduce a session on the military and military music. And for that reason, I could ask you a million and one questions. I'm not going to. I have one very straightforward question, but before I ask it, I would open the floor to anybody else who would like to ask you a question. Adam.
Actually, I think Matthew was first.
Thank you very much, Adam. Rachel, that was fantastic. The reason I've had this stupid smile on my face the whole time is because my whole PhD is basically focused on the German equivalent of what you're doing at the moment. Like you, I'm a student of the 19th century, and my own research is looking very much at the same topic you're looking at, the role of a military band during the formation of the German Empire and then the communal and social elements. I could not have thought, I had not heard a more in-depth, passionate and interesting analysis of our own military band, one that has such a long and in-depth history. And linking back to your final comment, I'm curious about how the military band reflects our own, and this sounds like a bit of a wishy-washy statement for musicological department, the musicological conference, but I'll say it anyway, how it reflects our own current emotional community, how a military band can reflect an emotional community post-World War II, post-jingoism, in an age where trust in the state and trust in state institutions is at mostly an all-time low. And I'm curious how your research can fit into that, particularly in the role of music and in the bands themselves. Like you were saying, bands are an integral part of any regiment. My own research has shown that as well. So I'm curious, how could you put that into your own work? Or would you want to put it into your own work?
Thank you. It's lovely to hear about the work that you're doing as well. And Barbara did forward on an email from you earlier, so I'm looking forward to talking properly after this at some point. You were in the images I could see while I was talking. Your picture was one of the ones that was there, and I really enjoyed seeing you smiling through it. It was nice to know that what I was saying was going down well. The connections between the 19th century practices and the present, and the elements of, I suppose, the balance between consistency and change. The fact that the bands have always been such fluid things, I find that quite difficult as a musicologist and historian who likes to preserve things, to capture things. The fact that the bands have always been fluid and adaptable, and that's kind of part of how they function, engaging with that as a scholar is I'm not quite sure how to navigate that yet, but the idea that change is, it just is. That's a balance between the way things are connected to the past, and practices from the 19th century are still very much there. And we've got this connection through music, through bands, to previous people, previous communities, where you feel that almost tangible link, which I find quite a powerful thing about military music in general. But then the extent to which it can... So the main question you asked there in terms of how music reflects... The present circumstance, whether that's the mood of the nation, the post, whenever that present circumstance was, whether it was a historical one or a present one. It's definitely something which I would like to look into, because that kind of comes down to the key point of all of this, isn't it? What are military bands trying to do, and how do they do it? And do they do what they're intended to do, or are they doing something completely different? And I think the fact that they're so often so functional, and it's very directly trying to link music to a purpose, to link music to reflection, to link music to communicating something. But sometimes that makes it almost get taken for granted that the bands are there, that what the bands are doing is there. So we don't need to worry about it because it's there and it's happening until it gets cut and then it's not there anymore. I'm not sure if that answered the question, but we should definitely...
No, that does, sorry. Yeah, it was a very open-ended question. Like I said, wishy-washy. But no, absolutely. I think it's really interesting looking at the example you gave. The Burma example was fantastic. Not only because Rudyard Kipling's poem is fantastic, and I have to admit, the veteran who did a far better job of it, did a better job of it than Charles Dance did in The Crown. But it is such an interesting comparison, looking at the band's emotional value back in the 40s and it is today, and the connection, but also where it can disconnect as well. I was fascinated by the use of therapy and the background music, because again, my own research follows a very similar route. A perfect example, actually, is, if you are interested in it, is the German troops returning from Afghanistan took part in what they called a Zapfenstreich. And watching it without no context, you'd think they were reenacting the Nuremberg rallies from the 1936. But this is a ritual that's been going on for hundreds of years. So absolutely, and I think this is a mine with a lot of rich veins to it. And I look forward to talking about it with you outside of this. But thank you, you have answered.
Thank you.
I think Adam had a question.
I'm just curious, is that I've been working a lot with military music, military bands. I mean, I've written a lot of wind band music, and I was the examiner at the Royal Marine School of Music for their degree there. I'm interested in the idea of the opportunities, of course, in new music for bands, taking into account the fact that it is music for particular sorts of occasions, and music that perhaps is maybe that its point is perhaps to sort of comfort rather than challenge. I wonder, thinking that so many, and there's a link with education here, because there are so many young wind, brass, percussion players who don't get into orchestras. This is perhaps even bigger in other European countries, and certainly in the USA. And whether the army band sort of reaches out to composers, young composers, and sort of there's a way of including them in what they do.
That's a really good question and a good point. And you're completely right that the opportunities for premiering more challenging new works or playing more challenging new works within military contexts are quite limited. That I know within my band, we don't do that many proper sit-down concerts, and within those you're generally playing for a particular audience, and how you're framing the repertoire you're in including is a challenging thing. But within rehearsals and our previous, I'm probably going back about three band masters now. I don't know if you've ever come across Ian Mitchell, a former regular army band master who has since become a composer. He'd be getting hold of all sorts of weird and wonderful stuff, which we were playing, but only playing in the context of the rehearsal. We'd have days where we'd come in and play new pieces from him and his fellow students at York or wherever he was studying at that point. People would write for us, they'd bring them along to us, we'd play this music, but we never had the opportunity to actually play it out. And I think that's probably reflected in, probably even more so with the recent restructurings, the regular bands aren't getting to do much concert work at all, but pretty much all they're doing is marching. So the vast stores of concert repertoire, whether recent or historic, that they're playing constantly in rehearsals for their own enjoyment, but aren't really getting so many opportunities to share.
Yeah. I understand that. I'm thinking more of, for example, we have two composers writing fanfares for the graduation ceremony coming up. And this idea that part of a composer's training is to write Gebrauch music, music for a function, music for a purpose, not necessarily art music that's going to sort of change the world. And I think, it's a very, very relevant thing. It's like, maybe somebody writing something for their local church, for the choir. And I think that is just as important as writing another orchestral piece. So I just wonder whether there's room, not necessarily for the army bands to play a challenging new work in a concert, which I totally understand is limited, but whether new fanfares, new marches, new pieces of ceremonial music can be thought about.
There certainly should be, shouldn't there? And that's quite a long way above my rank at the moment. But it seems like a very sensible thing that the army should be encouraging, and particularly given the enthusiasm for defence engagement, community engagement, building bridges with different groups. There is definitely an appetite for developing relationships with the universities, with the music colleges, probably with half an eye on recruitment. But given there is that interest in partnership building, then composition being a part of that partnership, and opportunities for student composers to write specific things for specific events that the bands are doing, would seem like a very good thing for both parties to be doing. I will have a chat with my boss about that for starters.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. Thank you.
Rachel, can I pose my question now? It's a very straightforward one, actually. Twice in the video excerpts you played, we heard Nimrod. And I can't recall Nimrod being used as a piece of remembrance music until quite recently. And at what point did this become the default remembrance piece, taken completely out of context, of course? And what is this saying about the way we are still using Elgar as the kind of default go-to composer when we want to express anything that's connected to British imperialism?
For the first part of that question, I don't actually know. I don't know at what point it first became used for remembrance. I feel like I ought to, because I've definitely given a lecture about that at some point, linked to early recordings of looking at how the speed that Nimrod is played has got slower and slower and slower and slower and slower as it has become so firmly embedded as a piece of remembrance, and comparing how you hear it now when played on remembrance events compared with the speed that Elgar actually took it. But precisely the timelines during which that happened, I'm not sure. In terms of the fact that it's still Elgar and still that piece being used, says a lot about musical institutionalism, doesn't it? And and certain pieces taking on layers of meaning over and above the meaning they're originally intended. And you can no longer have a Nimrod that is not associated with remembrance, I would say. It's that's such an embedded meaning that you can no longer hear it without those ears.
But at what point did it acquire that embedded meaning?
That's the bit that I don't know.
That's the question, isn't it?
Anyone else know?
It's rather like the use of the Barbara Dar show in the States. It's the go-to piece for remembrance. But all through my childhood and earlier days, I cannot remember Nimrod being used in remembrance services.
I've just written in the chat that a new Nimrod ought to be commissioned. Mm-hmm. There should be a competition for something that obviously has those resonances. Mm.
It often used to be the Walford Davis solemn melody that was used. Nimrod is very much a new departure, I think.
Has Dido's Lament been used for a long time as well, I wonder?
Yeah, I don't know that one.
Yeah.
Barbara has something to say. Barbara?
Well, Elgar takes on a sort of a role, really, around World War One, in a way that, why work on France, as you know, Debussy doesn't, or finds more difficult to do that musically, but Elgar really comes to the challenge. So I wonder, it'd be really interesting, those of you who work on British music, and we've got Annika in the room and others, to see when that starts to come through in commemoration of war, of First War, but also other wars, subsequent wars. So it is a very interesting question. I was really struck. I mean, it's fascinating because many of us work on conflicts of the past and with a very different sort of lens, I suppose, less of a personal engagement. And it's really interesting to see you, Rachel, apply the sort of your approach that you might to 19th century music, musical life, to this topic where you're in an insider as well. It is very, really fascinating. I'm interested in some of the documents that you were showing us, and we won't talk about universal whatever claims about music, we'll go there, but there were a couple of things that jumped out. One is about, well, obviously musical heritage and tradition, upholding that, and there's a ceremonial function, of course, and that's very evident. But then the music reflecting the identity of the personnel, which I wondered whether they were also referring to that older, the more ceremonial element, or is it just that the idea that it also has to serve the people who are involved in the conflict? So it's about now as much as about the past. There's a really interesting tension there. And which bit is supposed to reflect the identities? Because of course, British identities are very complicated. And you know, in terms of past, but also present, and what's on the iPod.
That's a really another really interesting point, which I'm just trying to think through. as a, yeah, so whose identity is being reflected. A big part of that will inevitably link through to ideas around regimental identity and core identity as much as individual identity, isn't it? The perceptions around the strength of the regiments still, and even as a part-time reservist, the affection I've got for the Royal Artillery is strong, but it's hard to imagine being in a different band. So all the layers of identity that get built up, and I suppose the movable identities of each one person having multiple identities depending on what space they're occupying at any one point. So, but which of those identities the doctrine was aimed at and had in mind at the point it was written, I don't know, but it's an interesting thing to think about more and explore a bit further if I get to talk to the right people somewhere along the lines. I'm just reading the comment from Dan Button in the chat. So one of my big worries about this talk was, what if I get an expert in the audience? So hopefully I didn't say anything you massively disagreed with through that.
Sorry, trying to unmute. No, it's fantastic. Thank you ever so much, Rachel. I would be very interested to see how that would transfer, this research would work in our environment as well, because we have some fundamental differences in the way that we operate and the way that we produce music. Perhaps we could have a chat offline at some point just to understand how things are different in the Army and the Royal Marines. Obviously, we very much focus on our traditions as well, as the Army do. But we, unlike the Army, haven't been as affected in the defence cuts in recent years. So there's maybe discussion there for what we're doing differently has allowed us to sustain ourselves, I guess, is maybe what I'm trying to say, in a different way to what the Army have tried to do with the changes of ensembles. It's certainly very interesting. And I think in a time of change for us, there's a, the whole Royal Marine Corps is undergoing a change that it was called the Future Commando Force, which we're fitting within that. And it's just becoming, you'll be aware of it in your research, but we're trying to understand how we're going to fit into that as we go forward at the moment. So hopefully there's some lessons that we can identify as general military music, which we can incorporate for ourselves. So yeah, thank you very much for tackling this subject. It's fantastic.
Okay, I'd love to talk more with you about all of this, definitely. And that's why I definitely need to be cautious with how I'm speaking. I'm hoping if I do get funding for this project further down the line, that I can be less cautious. But for now, given I need funding and permission and so on, it seems to me that part of the difference between the other arms and the Army is that the Marines have such a strong identity for their music anyway, that the way, and the same for the RAF, we are smaller numbers but so clear on the purpose and the collection of bands as a collection, where it feels at the moment like Army music is fracturing, that you have State Ceremonial has boxed itself off, and you've got the regional bands who, by becoming British Army Band Sandhurst, British Army Band, whichever location they happen to be in, that there's been a loss of identity there as well. And right when the Corps needs to be a strong collective, it's not quite managing to do that for some reason. So there are definite things to learn, things to discuss between the different groupings. Comment from my former supervisor, Richard, to say that NIMWA's been playing at royal funerals since at least George V. Hello, Richard. Lovely that you're here.
There are a few other questions in the that have come from YouTube.
So the one about, do you think the role of bands has changed since the pandemic? It's a bit early to say, really, isn't it? But certainly during the pandemic, it was a really interesting space to be occupying as a military musician. And the fact that we were able to keep on working at times when other musicians weren't, that because we fell under the army's rules about sort of guidelines and regulations around the military coming back to work, it was possible under very, very controlled circumstances. So outside as much as possible, 15 minute playing and then air the room for half an hour. But it was possible to come back and to play sooner than perhaps other groupings were able to. And it was also, given we were still being paid through this period, it was kind of, we were obligated to try and do something which was meaningful and which could contribute and which could continue to speak to the country, I suppose, in such challenging circumstances, hence the continuous stream of digital output, initially recorded entirely remotely, so everyone individually and stitching it together, but then further down the line, and trying to link that to national events, and whether it was as VE Day or VJ Day or Armed Forces or the military things, but also Christmas and New Year, and trying to have music which we were still putting out there for every purpose, because it was something that we could do that was meaningful and constructive. Possibly the all the good things that were happening musically during the pandemic, it's finding a way to continue to articulate that now that the financial implications are all beginning to bite. How do we make sure that music isn't cut too much, forgotten too much, when everyone was turning to it when they needed it?
Matthew, did you have another question?
If that's okay, I understand. I don't want to make a monopoly of asking questions. So Rachel, you're in the privileged position of not only studying music, but also participating. And I'm curious, as a question, the role of music as participation and as practice, as part, and how do you feel in that as a part, a member of the military? Is it the actual participation as a musician, or is it being part and practicing as a musician, or participating as part of a wider community or collective in the form of a regimental band? Or is there no difference? Is there just, because I'm just a bloody civilian after all, is there no difference between the two?
In terms of how I feel about it, so I didn't quite follow the question.
Sorry, the experience more so than that. So is it the playing of music, or is it the participating alongside other military musicians?
I guess it's a bit of a mixture, depending on what we're playing for. That sometimes we're all just there playing music and having a lovely time as musicians. And other times you are very, very aware of the significance of whatever you happen to be part of at that moment. And the different layers that there are to that are part of what I really enjoy about being in the band. That I struggled a lot as a student with the question of, what am I doing as a musician? You know, what does music do? What am I trying to do? Or what point do I have? And there's something quite refreshing at being in a band which has a point, doing music that has a very direct, tangible point. I find it quite a nice balance to the more abstract forms of music, which I'm also very much love and I'm still very much involved in. Yeah, lots of layers is the best answer I can come up with for that.
I think Harvey had a question.
Jeff, can you hear me, folks?
Very faintly.
Very faintly, just a minute. I'm having problems with this computer. Just a moment. Sorry, bear with me one sec. Do you want to take to somebody else while I try to...
Does anybody have a question?
I'm going to say, Jane, I've seen your comment in the chat, and I would love to talk to you about that too, that the question's about models of how music functions and to what extent it is actually performing identity. Yes, absolutely. We need to talk fairly soon, please. That would be brilliant. Is there anything else in the chat I need to know about? Amelia, I'm reading. Oh, sorry.
I was thinking, Harvey, could you put your question into the chat?
Yeah.
You can't be heard.
Amelia, I'm just reading your comments about the possibility of writing for the RAF and the challenges that came in around budgeting and commissioning and where that money would come from. Yes, I can very much understand that point, knowing the complexities of how the administrative side of finance works for the army and what money comes from what pot to do what. And even just within the tasking of bands, you've got five different categories of event, and justifying the use of public funds, whether it's something that can be fully funded, whether it's something that the whoever's booking the band needs to pay part of, whether it's something which needs to be fully paid for on a commercial basis. And every single engagement has to be justified, and every single bit of money that's spent has to be explained and accounted for within the regulations. So they're really quite, so I can imagine that trying to work out how you might get paid for a commission could have caused lots of headaches for lots of people.
It was very different, I think, to anything else I'd kind of, in terms of, also it was very, very early for me on. It was probably my second professional commission, and I didn't know that it was abnormal until after. And also in that kind of contract, I felt like they take the contract from any supplier. So it's as if you're supplying like a product, and there'd be things in there like, if we go to war, you won't get paid. And and then we went to COVID, which was a different type of war, perhaps. But no, it was very eye-opening, and it was kind of, I've actually had more stuff after that, and it's been funny to see how different a kind of artistic setting is in comparison, maybe. But I can imagine that creates a lot of, just whenever Adam was talking about opportunities for composers and how they're putting new music in, it seems like a very complicated process, and that's probably why it's kind of sparse.
And there's another question from Richard Westrick in the chat. What role is online playing or going to play in army music dissemination? Again, another good question. Certainly during the last 2 years, the bands have been very proactive at getting their content out there online. Now that the bands are back being busy in person again, I guess it's going to come down to a question of time and resources. It seems such a logical avenue to continue to use to expand the audience, to reach more people. But practically finding the time to create that digital output as well is becoming more of a problem. I know within my band that we're putting a lot less digital content out than we were, because we're off gigging every few days. So I don't know what sort of thing I'm learning, the grand plans and strategies. I don't know what plan there is for the use of media for dissemination longer term. But I don't think there was a really firm plan for the use of media for dissemination during the pandemic either. A lot of it was people in bands being proactive at putting together content and then abiding by certain overarching restrictions about what could or could not be shared. But it was individual driven rather than institutionally driven, and that will probably continue going forwards. Harvey, how are you getting on with your question?
Avi, are you able to come in with your question or not? Or do you want to do it offline?
Can you hear me at all?
Yeah.
Oh, great. Okay. It was really more of an observation than a question, quite honestly. And Rachel, you touched on this in several of your answers to other people's questions. But first of all, thanks. It was completely fascinating. And for me, fascinating on a number of levels. One was that the connection with history and historical music as well, and in practice, as opposed as well as the links that are maintained throughout a long period of time, and that links in with the functionality of the music as well. And my observation was simply one sort of aimed at government, in the sense that I find it incredibly ironic that the Department of Defence formally recognises moral cohesion, self-esteem, motivation, and the universality of music. The Department of Education recognises the vast benefits of music in education, from fostering cooperation in children to individual benefits such as improving behaviour, mental and emotional health, and empathetic development. And yet these qualities are still, it appears, not quite enough to retain either military music as central to that way of life, or is essential to every child's educational experience, and I find that deeply disturbing, quite frankly, despite the huge number of studies which have proven that this is the case. What is it we need to do, do you suppose?
Ah, there's a question. If any of us knew the answer to that question, we wouldn't still be discussing it, would we? Yeah, as you say, the rhetoric is there, the rationale is there, it's there very clearly in black and white in these documents. But it doesn't quite follow through to continuing to fund it, does it? Which is frustrating.
Or worse.
I've promised I won't be too controversial today.
Well, thank you anyway, Rachel. It was terrific.
Thank you.
Do we have any further questions, either from the floor or online, from YouTube? Well, can I conclude by saying, Rachel, thank you once again. It was a really thought-provoking presentation, and it was good to see how themes that might have emerged from your research in the past can feed into what you're doing now. And I think that's been borne out by some of the questions again, that time present is there in time past, or time past is there in time present. These wonderful threads of connectivity that we discover. So thank you once again. It's a pity we can't go to the bar, but I hope we will be able to meet up and talk about these things at some future time. Thank you once again.
Thank you everyone for coming along and watching.
Thanks, Rachel.